The devil wants to keep you from your destiny.
Your destiny is to dominate the earth.
The devil don't ever want you to be what God created you to be.
The Most High God created you to be rulers and owners of the land, not plantation workers.
When you discover your gift, here go the devil. You got this job over here, you gonna lose your 401k.
The devil will use fear tactics through your loved ones, friends, and even your brothers to get you to never go after what's truly yours.
But you gotta quit letting the devil keep you from your destiny by tying it to this little job you got.
You should obey God rather than man.
If you've been dreaming of opening that business, you should start the process.
Is working a 9-to-5 job a sin against God? That sounds like an obvious but crazy question, and I promise that by the end of this video, you'll have the answer with proof. So before I proceed, let me warn you, it might not be the answer you think. Before you come up with your own answer, I want you to consider this. The Bible is a history and prophecy book written about a royal family. The Most High God is God of all gods. His son, which the world calls Yahusha or Christ, that's the king of all kings on the earth, and the royal family, which are the Israelites, okay? And everybody else is just supposed to be peasants and servants, right? But it's a royal family. So let me ask you, with all your seasons of Games of Thrones, when have you seen the royal family working 9-to-5 labor jobs? If you know that you're in that royal family, you should also behave like it, right? So Exodus 19:6, and ye shall be unto me a kingdom of priests and a holy nation. These are the words which thou shalt speak unto the children of Israel, baby. All right, watch this though. So, well, now you might be saying, but David, what about all the curses we're under? How can we succeed? How can we stop being at the bottom with all the curses? We're supposed to be under the curses. That's how we know who we are. Well, what about the one where it says that you will get everything by the sweat of your brow, meaning hard work? That's why we have jobs, right? Okay, well, what about Deuteronomy 28:48? Therefore shalt thou serve thine enemies, which the Lord shall send against thee in hunger and in thirst and in nakedness and in the want of all things. He shall put a yoke of iron, and you know the rest, when he destroyed thee. But check this out. Well, I say, considering the fact that I even have to do this class, that the prophecy came true. We're literally destroyed if we think that our Father who art in heaven, that we're supposed to be the apple of his eye. We're destroyed if we believe that he wants us to stay at the bottom and then go to preach to everyone that we're kings and guys on the earth. Confusion. So every curse can be overturned, including hard labor jobs. So 2 Chronicles 7:14 states, if my people, which are called by my name, shall humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then will I hear from heaven and will forgive their sin and will heal their land. Okay, so that means overturning. That means reversing, correct? Okay, so that means you're not supposed to still be a servant, okay? Do you know what that means for all of us so-called woke people? If we're really woke and return to the Father, the curses should be dropping off of us like flies, okay? They're only still on you because you become comfortable as servants. In social media posts, we're always calling ourselves bosses. I'm on my boss stuff and all of that. But then we log off and clock into a 9-to-5 job. We must remember that no hypocrites get into the kingdom, people. If we're really woke, we would know that we can't be the CEO if we're stuck doing the janitor's work. Here's a scripture that shows that if we have jobs, we're probably still a little asleep. Revelation 18:4. And I heard another voice from heaven saying, come out of her, my people, that ye be not partakers of her sins, and that ye receive not of her plagues. You might say, David, now you're reaching. That has nothing to do with jobs. Now you're twisting the scripture. No, I'm going to keep going. Watch what I'm going to do, okay? Or how about 2 Corinthians 6:17? Wherefore come out from among them and be ye separate, said the Lord, and touch not the unclean thing, and I will receive you. So we talk about the interracial stuff, how we're supposed to come out from under them, the spiritual stuff, the different doctrines and all of that. But guess what? If you're still at the job, you're still up under them. If they can still tell you you can't take a high holy day off or something, that you're still up under them, how can you be ye separate when you are in the locker room with them, when you are paired with them, co-workers, literally? Now, how the heck do you come out from under them? Choose none of their ways and stop defiling the high holy days if you're stuck working for them. Watch this. So look at this picture. Doesn't this look familiar, man? You should be feeling it right now in your gut and in your spirit. All right, it says, now, aren't you sick of tired of being in this position? Every single time in your life when you filled out a job application, this is what you look like to them. It's a sin too. Let me prove all things, brothers and sisters. Proverbs 22:7. The rich ruleth over the poor, and the borrower is servant to the lender. The borrower is servant to the lender. You see, if you need to apply for the jobs, if you need to borrow their money, you're a servant. It doesn't matter if it's a high-paying job or not. You feel good with those manager positions. Does it sound like a freaking porch, you know what, or a house, you know what? You're still in the freaking plantation, guys. You understand what I'm saying? It doesn't matter how much you're getting paid. You're not the owner, and you can't pass an application down to your kids, okay? All right, royalty can't be bought. You shouldn't have a number that can stop you from owning your future instead of begging for it. The Most High God gave every single person a gift, and you are literally suppressing your gift and helping somebody else build theirs if you have a job. That's idolatry. Remember how I told you that I would prove having a boss is idolatry and a sin? Well, here's that scripture, Deuteronomy 17 and 15. Hope you guys are taking notes and tossing out the applications, because we are anti-job over here, baby. All right. Thou shalt in any wise set him king over thee. That sounds like a boss. Whom the Lord thy God shall choose. Oh, man. One from among thy brethren shalt thou set king over thee. Wow. So that means even if you do have some type of gig or something, everybody is an entrepreneurial spirited and don't know how to pull it out themselves, even though you can text the number in the description and we can help you reveal your passion in order to cash in. But even if you were to work a job, it's supposed to be under your own people in order to like increase the wealth of your nation. You're literally going against your own well-being and growth if you're not working for your own people. Okay. All right. So thou mayest not set a stranger over thee, which is not thy brother. Man, y'all heard this? She said she want my crew. Okay. So if you're a man of the Most High God, you're royalty and should not be kneeling to any man for what you need. I know what it says in Deuteronomy, guys, but after you come back, as you can see in the scripture that I read above, you are not supposed to be in this subservient position. So, oh yeah, and about those curses being overturned, let me get that. This is one that a lot of brothers use to keep people from becoming financially free in captivity. Keep in mind, any brother that convinces you to stay at the bottom either hates you, is unlearned, or afraid of their own failures and don't want you to succeed, because then it'll reveal their failures and fears. Deuteronomy 28 and 30 says, thou shalt betroth a wife, and another man shall lie with her. Thou shalt build an house, and thou shalt not dwell therein. Oh, we did a lot of that. Thou shalt plant a vineyard and shall not gather the grapes thereof. Ooh, you're still doing that. Look, when you're at the job, that's the plantation. You're planting the vineyards, but you're not eating the grapes thereof. When you're just getting $10 an hour and off of your labor, they're getting $10,000 an hour, you're building a house and not dwelling therein. You cannot pass it down. Okay, so the question is, just because it's a curse that we were under, does the Most High God want us to stay like this? If that were true, then why would he just a few chapters later or books later say this? Jeremiah 29 and 5, build ye houses and dwell in them, and plant gardens and eat the fruit of them. Oh, we don't stop there. Let's go to Isaiah 65 and 21. And they shall build houses. No. And inhabit them, and they shall plant vineyards and eat the fruits of them. So just like it's a curse, it's also a blessing. It's always two sides of the coin, guys. He gave us ultimatums. Everybody goes to Deuteronomy to show you the curses, Deuteronomy 28. But if you remember at the beginning of Deuteronomy 28, he told us the blessings first. It's on us for being hard-headed. But guess what? Once you come back to obedience, it doesn't have to be like that no more. Okay, boom. Now, remember this. Even though we didn't know who we were, look at this at the left, Black Wall Street. At least we had some cojones. All right. At least we had some, you know, some testes back then, some freaking testosterone, male hormone. You understand what I'm saying? At least we had some of that. Some brothers say, if we were meant to rebuild, why did the Most High God allow the destruction of Black Wall Street then? Well, our minds are not his, but he does leave scriptures to teach us for our learning. Right. So guess what? We're supposed to endure to the end. By the very definition of endure, it should tell you that things wouldn't be easy. Good men are tried through the furnace, heat, hot, not comfortable of adversity. So it lets you know that things wouldn't be easy. But even if, look, check this out. Does that mean we're supposed to give up? Now look over to the right. Look at the ant hill to the right and the ant. I know you guys remember kicking down those as kids, then to come back the next day and you'll see it rebuilt again, bigger, better, and stronger than ever by those same ants that you tried to destroy the day before. Well, are you telling me that those tiny creatures are smarter and stronger than us bold men, huh? Huh? Is that what you're telling me? Proverbs 6:6. Go to the ant, thou sluggard, slothful, lazy. Consider her ways and be wise. So I guess we aren't as smart as these tiny creatures. If the Most High God had to tell us, go and observe what happened over there. So look at that anthill right there. I knock it down. It builds back up. They get right back to work. Okay? They knock Black Wall Street down. Now we go to Walmart. All right? Come on, man. Listen. Okay, it says, which having no guide, overseer, or ruler, provided her meat in the summer and gathered her food in the harvest. They never stop doing the work. They're programmed to keep doing the work no matter what you do to try to destroy them. That is how relentless and diligent we are supposed to be. It should not have ever been a point where we have to start back rebuilding our nation and all of that. We supposed to hop right back up and be like, that didn't even hurt. That didn't even affect me. I'm still going. All right. Proverbs 30:24. There be four things which are little upon the earth, but they are exceeding wise. So he's saying it's creatures on the earth, you know, even though we got dominion and everything, right? It's creatures on the earth that are tiny, tiny, but they're smarter than us. It says the ants are people, not strong, yet they prepare their meat in the summer. So even though they're tiny, similar to us, even though we're not like the, you know, might not be the biggest nation or at the top and stuff like that, we're still supposed to, without leadership, know that we still got to put in the work, man. We still got to put in the work. The ant knows this, and we don't know this. All right, Proverbs 13:4. The soul of the sluggard desired. Sluggard, slothful, lazy, sitting waiting around. Oh, I got faith, but no works. It says that person will struggle. That person will always be begging. That person will always be unemployed, needing a job, needing someone to lend to them and everything like that, okay? All right, but if you get up off your butt, guess what? It says the soul of the diligent shall be made fat. In the scriptures, another word for fat is wealthy, rich, owning the great of the land, all of that, not wanting for anything. So do you see? You see how you've been led astray by so-called brothers that love you? Now, I'm not saying they do it intentionally. Some people just don't know because they're following other men. You have to read for yourself, okay? Study to show yourself approved, and you'll see that all this, oh, you're not supposed to be rebuilding stuff, is lies, okay? So now we see, no matter what happened to Black Wall Street, we should have rebuilt just like the ant. If we're really back, that is what we should be doing right now instead of working 9-to-5 jobs that don't benefit the nation at all. Huh? Listen. If you're a man of the Most High God and you have a job, consider this scripture while you look at this picture. Proverbs 13:22 says, a good man, meaning a righteous, God-fearing man, leaveth an inheritance to his children's children. Why? So that the curses don't continue. Every single time another baby is born, he is already programmed that he will have to get a freaking application and job or go to one of these stupid colleges because we are stuck thinking that we're supposed to get an education and then get a good job that you can't pass down. Your boss's children are not obligated to hire your children. It should be the other way around anyway. Okay? It said, a good man leaves an inheritance to his children's children, and the wealth of the sinner is laid up for the just. Let's get a precept. Now, in this next one, we have to stop thinking everything is a parable or a metaphor. Some things in the Bible are literal, mean exactly what this is, okay? Don't put your own interpretation. Look, watch this. Two different things. Wisdom is good with an inheritance. So a lot of people say, oh, man, when it talks about inheritance in the Bible, it's talking about passing down the laws. We're supposed to be passing down the commandments. Yes, in the scriptures, especially in Deuteronomy and in Genesis, it says that we're in Exodus as well. It says that we're supposed to pass down the commandments as an inheritance. I understand that. But you know language, okay? It says and in here, okay? With in here. It lets you know it's two different things in this sentence. Wisdom is good with. Noodles are good with hot sauce. Chicken is good with hot sauce. So that means chicken is not hot sauce. It's two different things. Wisdom is good with an inheritance. And I have a precept to prove this, okay? And by it, there is profit to them that see the sun, okay? So if you keep living and you know how to use wisdom with your inheritance, there's a lot of profit in that. You're going to live good along the land. So now, how do I prove that inheritance is not the same thing as wisdom? Inheritance is not the same thing as just the commandments, okay? So watch this. For those of you unlearned, the scripture does not say that money itself is the root of all evil. It states that the love of money is the root of all evil, because a lot of us get caught up in these camps and organizations and churches and let them tell us while they're living good that money is the root of all evil. That's not true, okay? All right? The love of money, the obsession, if you become obsessed with it, is no telling what you'll do to get it. I'd do anything for the bag. You hear people say that. Let me tell you what money is really for. Ecclesiastes 7 and 12. And this is how we know that that other scripture, the precept, was talking about two different things. For wisdom is a defense, and meaning including also money is a defense. So those are two things. That's the same scripture as the one I just said above. For wisdom is a defense and money is a defense. But the excellency of knowledge is, pause, comma, that wisdom giveth light to them that have it. Meaning a person with money should also have wisdom in order to live their best life. That's why they give Black people a lot of money. You see a lot of these celebrities with a lot of money, and you're like, oh, well, why they, if the world is racist against Black people, why are there Black millionaires? That's because they know that they don't have any wisdom with their money. So they don't know how to put up a good defense and rebuild a nation. Do you see now? Everybody knows these scriptures better than us, okay? There's nothing wrong with having money. You're just supposed to pass down wisdom with it of how to use it to protect you and to build a nation. All right, so now before I end this, I have a question. If our inheritance was only spiritual, why does the Bible emphasize the importance of having land in so many scriptures? You can't hire people to maintain all of that land on a Walmart salary, which proves that we're meant to have the wealth of the earth, but behave righteously with it. So also, why does the scripture brag so much about the wealth our forefathers had if we're meant to be a nation of broke 9-to-5 working men? Genesis 13 and 2. And Abram was very rich in cattle, not spirit. It didn't just say spirit. Abram was very rich in cattle, in silver. Oh, what was silver? And in gold. So wealth is not just spiritual wealth. Quit twisting scriptures. Quit reaching. Quit trying to lead brothers astray so that they'll stay on the bottom and be broke with you in a different version of crabs in a bucket, an Israelite version of crabs in a bucket. No. It says Abram was very rich in cattle, in silver, and in gold. Why mention all of that if none of that means anything? Everything was written for our learning, right? Letting you know that a good spiritual man should not be struggling. Okay? Jump down. Genesis 13 and 5. Why do we have to keep mentioning this? And it said, and Lot also, which went with Abram, had flocks and herds and tents. These people had assets. We're so proud to always reach back and talk about our forefathers to cover our sins and do lustful stuff and all of that. But when it comes to rebuilding the nation and the wealth of a nation, we always try to like dismiss anything. Well, guess what? Pay attention to our forefathers when it comes to this. Genesis 14 and 14. Watch this. Yo, watch this. And when Abram heard that his brother was taken captive, he armed his trained servants. Woo! I don't know about you, but man, when I worked at the mall, I was not going to be able to hire trained servants. Like my budget wouldn't allow for that. The way my bank account set up, man. Born in his house. So not only did he have servants, they were born there, meaning he had to have many rooms. 318. Wow. Wow. I don't really think food stamps would be able to feed 318 people in a house. I don't think your dang on welfare check. I don't think your TANF. I don't think your Inframil. I don't think your freaking child support checks. I don't think your end of the year tax returns will be able to feed 318 people serving, all born in your house, including your family. So how do you do that on a job? You cannot. Okay. So our forefathers were not broke just because they were spiritual. Okay. That is a lie, and people are pulling more wool over your dang on eyeballs, all right? Even a Proverbs 31 woman, which everybody seems to talk about, knew to make clothing and belts to sell them on a merchant ship. She also considered a field and bought it, which would be very difficult to do if she worked down the street at Taco Bell, right or wrong. So calling ourselves a woke chosen people, then turning around and working under the heathen willingly is idolatry. You're saying that they are better than us. Leave an inheritance, man.